In the United States Army, the men and women of the Chemical Corps are known as Dragon Soldiers. They specialize in responding to weapons of mass destruction. Their phone rings when the threat is chemical, biological, radiological, or nuclear. CBRN, or CBRN for short. On the battlefield or in homeland defense, they go where a single breath or an inch of unprotected skin can kill you. They identify the threat and map the hazard zone so that rescue teams can work safely. They cleanse people of contamination to save lives and reduce suffering. You are about to see how they do this. At Fort Polk, Louisiana, the Joint Readiness Training Center creates intensive, realistic conditions in a training area known as the Box. In the Box, we'll follow the Red Dragons of the 2nd Chemical Battalion, the Army's most senior chemical unit, as they deal with a massive radiation hazard.
There are only 2,300 soldiers in CBRN units across an active Army that is going to 450,000. We have to be ready for a wide variety of contingencies. We provide chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear response, hazard identification, mitigation, and some level of remediation in order to make it safe for human beings to come back and operate and live in that environment that has been affected by some type of weapon of mass destruction.
DCERT is the military's support of civilian response to a bad thing that's happening across the United States. We have a DCERT unit, which is a Department of Defense unit made up of Army forces, made up of Marines, Navy, Air Force, Coast Guard. We have a whole bunch of parts to it. And they are standing ready to respond to anywhere in the continental United States in case something bad happens. In this case, our scenario is a nuclear power plant is emitting radiation.
The JRTC has simulated an accident at a nuclear plant. The forest and nearby towns have been designated as badly contaminated hot zones. In and around these contaminated zones are uncounted role players taking the part of civilian victims. Many of them have been exposed to radiation. Their bodies and clothing must be treated as hazardous to others.
The Joint Readiness Training Center, we are able to do DCERT rotations. We are able to handle units jumping into a foreign country to seize and secure an airhead. We are able to train pretty much anything the Army needs us to train or the Department of Defense needs us to train. The amount of money, effort, and mental energy spent here is possibly the reason why our military is so good. We make it as realistic as possible.
The biggest thing is like the realism of the training and all the different scenarios that they get to throw in, because then it shows them a different outcome of how it can be in a realistic situation. So,
yeah.
Like, you know, hey, different scenarios as far as like, hey, you guys lost power, or no water. So now what do you do now? What are your battle drills to you know, focus on now that you don't have any power or water? So to me, the training aspect of it is the best thing, because then the more hands-on training we get, then the better we are.
Local towns are within the hot zone affected by radiation, so the task force commander sets up a tactical operations center to control and track thousands of soldiers, hundreds of vehicles, and all their supplies. Right at the heart of this huge organization are the three chemical companies that we will follow into the Box. The DeSoto operations base is set up next to the hot zone. It's a quiet meadow in the southern pine forest, usually inhabited only by wild horses. But just up the hill, you see the signs of the disaster. The task force moves in to set up its operations. The meadow is soon covered by vehicles, equipment, tents, and soldiers. Now, this is your company's first time in the Box for a DCERT mission. What are you expecting?
I think number one is just really to challenge the soldiers. Most times they conduct the operations and they may do it in bits and pieces, but this would be the full full up. Our entire task force now are in the same place at the same time. So how operations work will be a little bit different from what we normally do back at home station practicing by ourselves.
First thing you save lives, mitigate suffering, sir.
Anything can go wrong, but actually I feel really great, especially with the team we have. And I feel very confident in these soldiers that they're capable of what they're doing.
The 172nd Chemical Company is tasked with setting up the facilities for MCD, Mass Casualty Decontamination. A huge expanse of bisqueen is laid out so that contaminated wash water can be collected and pumped to the safe pond for disposal. Warrant Officer Latimer briefs the platoon on exact placement.
All right. See that stop sign right there? Okay. Now, the road runs like this, right there, right? We're currently like this. What I want to see is the bisqueen over here running this way. The problem that we have is the terrain. It is flatter on that top side right there. We cannot have it so where the smoke is towards the rear. Right, we cannot have water rolling backwards.
Under Latimer's direction, a team of soldiers relocates the bisqueen to the correct alignment. Other soldiers unload trucks, carry equipment to its designated location, and erect tents to house the MCD, the Mass Casualty Decontamination Line, which will process up to 4 casualties per minute at peak operation. During the setup activities, there is no way to relieve the distress of the local population. Most are contaminated with radiation. Many are designated as injured and dehydrated. All show fear and frustration. Some can see the activity just a few yards away and their anger mounts. But the Dragon soldiers must focus their efforts on preparing to help hundreds, possibly thousands, as soon as possible. While the MCD is being set up, the task begins of entering the hot zone, where everything must be considered contaminated with radiation. This is a reconnaissance and surveillance, or RNS, or recon mission. Rescue and medical teams cannot enter the hot zone safely until Dragon soldiers complete the CBRN reconnaissance.
Dismounted RNS, which is what you see here, actually goes in with whatever element goes in first. It might be search and rescue, it might be a collapsed building, it might be a tunnel. Their job is to make sure that the team that is going in, and they're monitoring the whole time, make sure that they're not going into hazards. And if they do go into a hazard, they understand exactly what it is, they've got the right PPE, and that they're actually monitoring the amount of exposure of whatever that hazard is. And then also to come back safely.
So our RNS platoon is going to be going down range and assessing the area, assessing the site, and that kind of feeds into follow-on operations for the urban search and rescue folks who will be going in and extracting personnel. So they'll be, at any given time on the MCD line, we'll have 3 lines of effort. MCD running, you have RNS running operations, and then you also have the urban search and rescue folks that will be running operations.
The target for this recon mission is a parking garage that has collapsed. On the way, the Seaburn team passes the hotel. Every human instinct argues for stopping to help these victims, but the Dragon soldiers must ignore the cries they hear from the windows. If they delay their mission to offer help, as they want to, they will delay the rescuers to follow, who have the resources to mitigate suffering. Trying to rescue a few now will delay the rescue of hundreds later, perhaps fatally. The recon team measures radioactivity so that rescuers will know what protective equipment is needed, where they can work safely in relatively clean areas, and what degree of radiation to expect on survivors. Approaching the garage, the team finds a casualty pinned under a massive concrete block. They check for signs of life and degree of contamination. They take photographs so the engineers, who will come later, know the challenge they must overcome in moving the obstacle. The team proceeds around the perimeter of the garage. At every step, they monitor for radiation and call out for survivors.
Anybody in there?
The team is observed and monitored by OCTs, Observer Controller Trainers, who will critique the performance and who insert challenges into the scenario as it takes place. Their activities are recorded on camera for later review. The structure is unstable. If they go in, there is a risk of further collapse. The team looks for weak points. They take photographs and measurements that are sent to the engineers, who will shore up the structure for entry. Progress is slow because the suits and masks reduce visibility and the footing is unsure. A wrong step or a shifting piece of concrete could sprain an ankle or even break an arm or leg.
Is there anybody else in there? We're here to help you.
The team's calls are answered at one point by a survivor trapped in the rubble. They report this, take pictures, and mark the spot. Again, it is natural to attempt rescue, but if they try to reach this victim, the structure may collapse further onto themselves and onto anyone else who is trapped. They move on, unable to offer any help except reassurance that other rescuers will follow.
All right, stay where you are. Help is on the way.
After a full examination of the garage structure, the team turns to leave the hot zone. On the way out, they encounter a group of civilians who are nearing desperation. Members of the team talk with them, trying to be reassuring through the muffled speech of their masks, but they are not equipped to offer any help. In real life, it would be heartbreaking to pass by people in such distress. In the box, Dragon soldiers experience the process of making the right decision. Carry on with the mission because that will save the most people in the shortest time. With no resources to help, the Dragon soldiers can only make promises and, once again, move on. The recon team must be decontaminated to avoid transporting radioactive material to the cold or safe zone. First they vacuum each other, then they are water washed. Before removing the suits, there is a final radiation check. The suits themselves, even though presumed clean, are bagged and stored for safe disposal. Across the road, the MCD setup is complete. Civilians have begun to make their way to DeSoto Base in small numbers.
two sides to the MCD. There is ambulatory and non-ambulatory. So as you saw, and I'm sure you got footage on this, people see these individuals coming in and they ascertain, okay, this guy can walk, this guy can move about himself. Okay, this guy definitely needs to be, you know, on a stretcher. That's what you see.
It's important to meet the victims and direct them to the MCD line. If they go from the hot zone to the cold zone on their own, they will endanger others and make safe areas unsafe. Victims are assessed and given a tag that will be used to track their medical and decontamination status. Those who can walk are escorted to the ambulatory line. Those who are unconscious or severely injured are brought to decontamination on stretchers. All the victims are afraid. They have no resources of their own and they fear radioactivity. The Dragon soldiers try to show that caregivers are in charge and that the victims are no longer on their own. Once in the decon line, the victim's personal items are placed in a bag that goes with the owner. Then the victim's outer clothing is cut away. This is an important step since 90% of the radioactivity is on clothing or skin. Water is used to wash away any remaining contamination. The MCD team is as gentle and reassuring as possible, communicating as well as they can that the victim is safe and events are under control. After washing, each person is monitored to ensure that decontamination is complete. They are now in the back end of the MCD line, and the examiners are thorough to make sure that no radioactivity is carried into this safe area. With the victim free of radiation, medical concerns become paramount. Each person is dried and kept warm, a basic treatment for shock. The MCD team now passes them to the medical tent for further care as the next victim comes down the line. The 21st Chemical Company conducted a relief in place, or RIP, taking the place of the 172nd on the MCD line. They have been working the line for 15 hours. The 181st Chemical Company is racing to conduct its own RIP and give the 21st some needed rest. They know that exhaustion can lead to serious mistakes.
People just rushing through and not listening and just trying to get through as fast as possible, which can spread it from the hot zone to the cold zone.
would have to abandon everything and set up shop somewhere else.
Civilians continue to challenge the Dragon Soldier's ability to stay on mission. This man has wandered away from the medical line where he was being treated.
I threw up some black stuff or something. Something hit me in my head. I have no idea what it is.
Okay, let's go. Let's get moved. I need everything. Get some soldiers who not getting men monitored. Get my entire CP. Let's go.
You said something about a first time for a relief in place?
Roger. It was the first time we attempted to do a relief in place in Task Force 503. That's what we were trying to do this morning. So currently we're still doing the RIP, but all operations have signed on.
How are you feeling your objectives are being met?
Right now we're still going to execute. We're still going to meet my training objectives.
With the relief complete, Captain Wallace and First Sergeant Rodney gathered the company for a short after-action review. And congratulations on a tough but well-executed shift. The Dragon Soldiers are in good spirits.
It's all about maintenance, all about maintenance. Don't work without maintenance.
The 21st makes the long drive to their sleeping quarters. It's not luxurious, but nobody is complaining.
So how was it?
It was tough. I think every possible thing you could throw at a soldier happened to us last night. From navigation at night, to the linking up of personnel, to coming to a site that's completely blacked out. We have to have our own power generation and light generation into an area where all of their power is out. That was very challenging. Thank God my soldiers came prepared because we did a lot of PCCs and PCIs, but it was extremely challenging. We started our operation. We actually departed the RSC at 1700 yesterday. It is now 1025 of the following day, and we're just now getting off shift. So I think today we kind of stretched our soldiers probably to the max. Anything you can think of that Murphy could bring at us, it did. From having three different missions going on at one time, that was definitely tough to keep track of.
What were the three?
The three missions was we had a reconnaissance mission for the 2nd platoon of 21st Camp. We also had the 554, 3rd platoon of the 554 Engineer Company that was tasked organizing for us. And their task was to go out and conduct extraction of personnel. And then we also had my decon team that does the mass casualty decon. So we had all three operations going on at the same time and all in the same village. So it was definitely interesting, but we learned a lot of lessons and definitely a lot to take back.
I had a soldier get sick and we're already short. So, you know, we had to kind of stretch our manning. So, which allowed me, myself, and Chief, my XO, to get into suit as well. So it was long hours, but the guys were motivated, kept us motivated, and just stayed in the fight.
A chemical hazard of unknown nature has been reported in the hot zone. It could be a laboratory. maybe an illegal drug lab, maybe a legitimate scientific laboratory. Even a hardware store has a plentiful supply of toxic materials that could be released by the force of a tornado. The Dragon Soldier's job is to go into the heart of the threat, identify it, assess it, and map it so that it can be brought under control. Decon and earlier RNS were carried out in gray suits that used filters to purify breathing air. Chemical vapors could penetrate the filters, causing severe injury or death to the person inside. This mission will require level A suits, so completely sealed that nothing can come in. Even breathing air and radios are carried inside the suit with the soldier. The team is briefed on their mission.
You're going to go, you're going to do an outside site sketch of all seven buildings. We're trying to hit as many buildings as you can within your time of your oxygen tanks. Again, you're looking for any signs of anything chemical, looking for any signs of personnel. Look through windows, look through doors, knock on windows, knock on doors, see if you see any movements, see if you stir anybody inside. Try to look, listen. Use your detection equipment, scan on the doors, just like you would for a normal entry, but you're not going to make entry. Just enter every building. Or as you get to every building, go ahead and call up your air. And if you can finish that building, call up your air as well. So I know when your air levels are for each building, so I can tell you whether you come back or how much come back.
They will enter the hot zone, then examine the outside of seven buildings. They will use high technology detectors to identify and map the presence of chemicals. Once they have identified and localized the hazard, another team will go in to take samples from the structures involved. This area is quiet and deserted. The voices and engines of the cold zone seem far away. The air smells of pine, but the soldiers in their level A suits don't know it.
Roger, copy. What's your lowest man on air?
Low man on air is 30.
I got 3000 PSI.
A team member checks each door and window with a paper that will change color on contact with powder or residue of chemical agents. Other detectors check for the presence of toxic vapors, and radiation levels are monitored as well. All this information means that later teams can operate with better knowledge of the hazards and therefore greater safety.
2500, Sergeant.
The soldier on the right looks as if his arm is hanging limply by his side. That is just the suit's sleeve. He has pulled his arm into the suit, maybe to use his radio or to make a note in his field book. He will get back into the sleeve by thrusting his arm up in the air. Although they will not enter any buildings, the team can report on what they see through the windows. At one building, some toxic chemicals appear to have escaped their containers.
Everything's right. 5 gallons.
Is there anything actively spilling from it?
Actively can't tell, but I can tell something spilled out of it.
Roger, good copy.
Low man on air 22.
Roger, we've got low man on air 2200. Be advised, you've only got 15 more minutes on target.
The long walk to the target and the afternoon heat has used up a lot of the team's air. They have gone from 3,000 to 2,200 PSI pressure and have only completed two of the seven buildings. Safety requires that they turn back when any soldier's air drops to 1,200 PSI.
One. whole world, I have one soldier, right? And then you collapse, get a little shaky, and things out of it.
Roger, go ahead and push back to decon.
Are you good?
One team member says he is getting a little hot. The team leader knows that the soldier is on the verge of heat exhaustion. If he collapses, they will have to carry him back and maybe use up their air before they get out of the hot zone. The mission will have to be terminated, and the team begins the long walk back to the decon tent. At the decon tent, each Dragon soldier is vacuumed, then sprayed with a solution to neutralize any chemical residue. After a water wash to remove radioactive particles, they are monitored again at the back end of the line, and finally their suits are removed. Last of all, the decon team decontaminates each other. Today, the hotel is a staging area for civilian role players, each one ready to make his or her particular demand on the Dragon soldiers they encounter. The size and complexity of this effort shows how serious the Army is about realism and training.
To get out here?
Basically exactly what role playing is.
You know what I'm saying? Getting out there and following instructions as far as what my sign says to do.
Oh, they give you a sign?
Yeah. Yeah, very, very nice. Very
so nice. You know what a 17-year-old with a head injury is like, so you just act like
that. Yeah, right, because I've been 17 before with head injury, so
yeah.
It's easy for me.
I'm an 82-year-old woman, only on Fort Polk base.
Hey, man.
For the days pretend like my side hurt me, you know what I'm saying, and see how fast what's gonna do for me and everything.
So you're supposed to be pushing, take care of me, make me well.
Yeah, make me well. Side hurting, my ribs broke, you know what I'm saying, so I'm gonna do it right today, you know what I'm saying.
All right.
Me and my co-worker.
Yeah, right here.
Yeah. How did you find, do you do this often or?
Nah, my first time doing this right here.
Oh, okay.
You know what I'm saying, first time experience. I think it's a good experience.
How did you find out about it?
It was online.
Oh, it's online.
Yeah, it's okay. Online. You can get experience there. Y'all check it out.
More and more civilians are finding their way to the MCD. The word has spread, and civilian agencies are transporting victims here in large numbers. The Dragon soldiers are preparing to operate at peak capacity.
They're going to give us a bunch of different scenarios, maybe rushing to the front of the line, giving our guys... dealing with a civilian populace is a lot different than dealing with a combat... or over in the Middle East, that type of stuff, where we're actually, we can control it with weapons, we have protection measures, now we have no weapons, we're having to verbally control the crowds and to get them through the MCD line as fast as possible. Maybe they're showing up with kids, maybe they're showing up with animals, they're service dogs. So it's our soldiers getting that training, that practice on dealing with the civilian populace instead of in a combat environment.
Boy, that is beautiful.
Fell down the stairs. It don't hurt that much as long as I don't move it. 2 days it's been like this.
I bet.
I'm dying.
The role players have fun with the civilian roles, but the soldiers treat every case with the deadly seriousness of reality.
This is the most important mission that anybody in this uniform could possibly do. Because this mission is actually saving our own families. That's what this is about. It's saving lives. The civilian population, when something really happens, this uniform is going to calm them down. This uniform is what they trust.
Yeah, I'm gonna throw up.
Yeah,
I'm gonna throw up.
Yeah,
I'm gonna throw up.
Shout out to the one that is. Bless him up.
What are we doing in here?
Killing people.
Is it safe to go in there?
It is, sir. You want to see them?
At least the clothes.
I need you to have a lock cross, sir. You have a lock cross?
The ambulatory cases can walk through, shower, and dry themselves. There are non-ambulatory cases as well, and some of them become non-ambulatory right in front of the Dragon Soldiers.
One's going is under there, it's not unconscious. Help it. Get somebody out here.
A young soldier faces the conflict between the mission and how to be humane to a victim who is injured and hysterical. That is what the box teaches. Some of the wounded are quiet and not demonstrative, but it is no less sobering to treat them. The company operations center maintains control as the long day wears on. Each soldier's time in the suit is monitored to prevent fatigue and overheating. The line of distressed and injured never seems to get any shorter, and the cries for relief never cease.
Kind of describe the arrhythmia. The first time they did that, and I believe it was in the hour of darkness because I was hearing when that was happening. It took anywhere between, depending on who you ask, 5 hours to 7 hours. The standard for just the MCD line is 2.5. And that came from, number one, dark, probably has something to do with it. The units not being familiar with each other. They've done some training, but not all together. And then figuring out who deconflicts, who's in charge as one task force comes in and the other one relieves them. Today, so this is about 3 rotations of doing these rips. I believe that it's taking less than 2 hours. That's what the estimate is based on the last one that happened. So that's a phenomenal cut in time. You know, this is about how do we turn chaos into something that's manageable? How do we make people calm? How do we make them feel safe? You know, so we can curb life of the American people to normal. To see how much they have learned, even within the last 24 hours, is amazing. And how adaptable they are to some of the things that they're being thrown. And the most exciting thing that was said to me yesterday by several OTCs is that they said, you know what? They don't even need the commander, the first sergeant. You know, I turned around and looked at him and said, why do you say that? And he goes, because we had specialists and privates that took charge. Everybody knew their job. They knew what to do and where to fill in. And that was just a beautiful thing, you know, to hear about your people. That is probably one of the best compliments that you can hear as a company commander, definitely as a battalion commander, that, you know, you don't need the leadership. That means that you have trained everybody to replace you.
I am very confident in our soldiers' abilities, and we are trained and proficient at our duties and what we do. We've been preparing for this moment for months. We have done our research, we have trained, we have worked long, hard hours, and we will stop at nothing to make sure that the people of America are safe.
At dusk, the 21st Chemical Company returns to DeSoto and conducts another relief in place, taking over the MCD and night recon missions. Then the JRTC exercise will close. DeSoto becomes a meadow once again, and the horses graze wherever they want, until another training rotation begins with other units and other missions. In a real incident, the MCD might operate for weeks. In the short but intensive JRTC rotation, the companies have made mistakes and learned lessons that will mean smooth operation should such an incident occur. And that, ultimately, is the purpose of the Joint Readiness Training Center and the objective of every Dragon soldier.